tired, as if she hadn't slept at all. Have you found out anything, Cynthia? Cynthia Stillwell asks once she's invited them in. Razbeck is struck by the similarities with the house next door. The layout is the same. The carved wooden staircase curving to the upper floor, the marble fireplace, and the front window are identical, but each home has their own unmistakable stamp of its own occupants. The Condy's home is done in subdued colors and filled with antiques and art. The Stillwells has more of a modern leather furniture, white glass and chrome tables, and punches of bright color. Cynthia takes a chair in front of the fireplace and elegantly crosses one leg over the other, dangling a sandal foot featuring perfectly painted scarlet toenails. As she and Jennings seat themselves on the sleek leather sofa, Razbeck smiles regretfully and asks, "I'm afraid we are not at a liberty to discuss details." The woman across from them seems nervous. He wishes to put her at ease. "What do you do, Mrs. Stillwell?" She asks. "I am a professional photographer," she says. "Freelance mostly." "I see," he says, flicking his eyes to the walls, which display several nicely framed black and white photos. "Yours?" "Yes, actually." She gives a small smile. "It is a terrible thing, the baby being taken," Razbeck says. "It must be very unsettling for you." "I can't stop thinking about it," she says in evident distress. She furrows her brow. "I mean, they were here when it was happening. Here we all are, having a good time, oblivious. I feel awful." She licks her lips. "Can you tell me about the evening?" Razbeck says. "Just tell me about it in your own words." "Okay," she takes a deep breath. "I had planned a party for Graham's 40th birthday. He just wanted something small, so I invited Marco and Anne for dinner, because we sometimes have dinner together and we are all good friends. We used to have dinner together a lot before the baby, not so much after. We hadn't seen much of them for a while." "Did you suggest that they leave the baby at home?" Razbeck asks. She flushes. "I didn't know they couldn't get a sitter." "My understanding is that they had a sitter, but she canceled at the last minute." She nods. "Right, but I would never have said they couldn't bring the baby if they didn't have a sitter. They showed up with the baby monitor and said the sitter had canceled, and they would just plug the monitor in and check on her a lot." "And what did you think of that?" "What did I think of that?" she asks, raising her voice, her eyebrows in surprise. Razbeck nods and waits. "I didn't think anything of it. I'm not a parent. I assumed they knew what they were doing. They seemed fine with it. I was too busy getting the dinner prepared to give it much thought," she adds. "To be honest, with one of them leaving every half an hour to check on her, it would have probably been less disruptive for them to have the baby here." Cynthia pauses. "On the other hand, she's a pretty fussy baby. Anne and Marco, you say they went next door to check on the baby every half an hour?" "Oh yes, they were rigid about it, the perfect parents." "How long would they be gone when they checked on her?" Razbeck asks. "It varied." "What do you mean?" She tosses her black hair over her shoulder and strengthens her back. "Well, when Marco went, he'd be pretty quick, like 5 minutes or less. But when she would stay longer. I remember I joked with Marco at one point that maybe she wasn't coming back." "When was this?" Razbeck leans forward slightly, fastening his eyes on hers. "I think around 11, but she was gone for a long time. When she did come back, I asked her if everything was all right. She said everything was fine. She just had to feed the baby." Cynthia nodded firmly. "That's right. It was 11, because she says she always feeds her baby at 11, and the baby sleeps through until about 5. Cynthia suddenly looks uncertain and adds, "When she came back after 11 o'clock feeding, it looked like she had been crying." "Crying? Are you sure?" "That's how it looked to me. She washed her face after, I think. Marco looked at her like he was worried. I remember thinking it must be a bore having to worry about Anne all the time." "Why do you think Marco was concerned?" Cynthia shrugs. "Anne can be moody. I think she's finding motherhood harder than she expected." She flushes, realizing the awkwardness of what she just said, given the circumstances. "I mean, motherhood has changed her." "Changed her how?" Cynthia takes a deep breath and settles more into her chair. "Anne and I used to be friends. We used to have coffee, go shopping, and talk. We actually had a lot in common. I'm a photographer, and she worked in an art gallery downtown. She's mad about abstract art. At least she used to be. She was darn good at that gallery. A good." The camera. much of him. He seems the same to me. But I think Anne has been bringing him down a little bit. He still likes to have fun. Razback X. Did Anne and Marco speak privately after the return from checking on the baby? What do you mean? Did you and your husband go into the kitchen to clean up or anything? Or leave them alone together at all during the evening? Did they sit together in a corner or anything? I don't know. I don't think so. Marco was mostly hanging out with me because you could tell that Anne wasn't in a too cheerful mood. So you don't remember them conferring together throughout the evening? She shakes her head. No, why? Razback ignores the question. Describe how the rest of the evening went, if you don't mind. We were sitting around in the dining room mostly because it's air conditioned and it was such a hot night. Marco and I were doing most of the talking. My husband is generally pretty quiet, sort of an intellectual. He and Anne were alike in that way. They get along. And you and Marco get along. Marco and I are more extroverted for sure. I liven up my husband and Marco livens up Anne. Opposites attract, I guess. Razback waits, letting silence fill the room. Then he asks, when Anne came back after 11 o'clock feeding, besides looking like she might have been crying, did she seem different in any way? Not that I noticed. She seemed tired, but that's the way she is these days. Who checked on the baby next? Cynthia thinks. Well, Anne got back around 11:30. I think so. Marco didn't go. He was going on the half an hour, and she was going on the hour. So that's the arrangement they had. So Anne went again at midnight, and then Marco went at 12:30. How long was Anne gone when she went to check the baby at midnight? Oh, not long. A couple of minutes. Yes. And then Marco went at 12:30. Yes, I was in the kitchen cleaning up a bit. He slipped out the back door saying he was going to pop out and check on the baby, and he'd be right back. He winked at me. He winked at you. Yes, he'd been drinking quite a lot. We all had. And how long was he gone? Razback asks. Not long. 2 or 3 minutes. Maybe 5. Cynthia shifts in her seat, recrosses her legs. When he got back, we went outside on the patio for a cigarette. Just the two of you. Yes. What did you two talk about? Razback asks. He remembers the way Marco flushed when he mentioned having a cigarette with Cynthia. Remembers how angry Anne had been about her husband flirting with the woman sitting across from him. Cynthia says, not much. He lit me a cigarette. Razback waits. Says nothing. He begins stroking my legs. I was wearing a dress and the slit up aside. She looks uncomfortable. I don't think any of this is relevant, do you? What does this have to do with the baby being kidnapped? Just tell us what happened if you don't mind. He was stroking my legs and then he got all hot and pulled me into his lap. He kissed me. Go on, Razback says. Well, he got pretty excited. We both got a little carried away. It was dark. We were drunk. How long did this go on? I don't know. A few minutes. Were you not worried about your husband or Anne coming out and finding you and Marco embracing? To be honest, I don't think we were really thinking too clearly. As I said, we had a lot to drink. So nobody came and found you? No. I eventually pushed him off of me, but I was nice about it. It wasn't easy because he was all over me. Persistent. Are you and Marco having an affair? Razback asks bluntly. What? No. We're not having an affair. I thought it was just a harmless flirtation. He's never touched me before. We had too much to drink. After you pushed him away. Then what happened? We straightened ourselves and we went back inside. What time was it then? It was almost 1, I think. Anne wanted to leave. She didn't like that Marco and had been with me on the back patio. I bet, Razback thinks. Were you out on the patio any time earlier in the evening? She shakes her head. No. Why? I'm wondering if you had an opportunity to notice whether the motion detector light went on when Marco went into the house any time earlier in the evening. Oh, I don't know. I didn't see him go over there. Other than that, then you and your husband and Marco and Anne, of course, do you know if anyone else knew that the baby was alone next door? Not that I'm aware of. She shrugs her elegant shoulders. I mean, who else would know? Is there anything you can add, Mrs. Stillwell? She shakes her head. I'm sorry. I'm afraid not. It seems like a normal night to me. How could anyone imagine something like this happening? I wish they just bought the baby with them. Thank you, ma'am, for your time. Razback says and rises to go. Jennings stands up beside him. Razback hands her his card. If you remember anything at all, please give us a call. Of course, she says. Razback looks out the front window. The reporters are milling around. would she lie? She is pretty hot. People lie all the time. In my experience, Razbeck says, do you think she was lying? No, but something about her is off, and I don't know what it is. She seemed nervous, like she was holding something back or hiding something, Razbeck says. The question is, assuming she's telling the truth, why was Marco making it pass her shortly after 12:30? Was he able to do that because he had no idea that his baby was being taken roughly at the time? Or he did it, he do it because he just handed the baby off to an accomplice and had to look like he didn't have a care in the world? Or maybe he's a sociopath, Jenny offers. Maybe he handed up the baby off to an accomplice and didn't even bother him at all. Razbeck shakes his head. I don't think so. Virtually all the sociopaths Razbeck has come across, and after decades on the force, he's come across a few that have had their air of confidence, even grandiosity about them. Marco looks like he's about to crack under the strain. Chapter 11. Anne and Marco wait in the living room by the phone. If the kidnapper calls Razbeck, or if Razbeck isn't there, someone else from the police will be present to coach Marco through the call. But there is no call from the kidnapper. Family and friends have called, reporters, cranks, but no one claiming to be the kidnapper. Marco is the one answering the phone. If the kidnapper does call, Marco would do the talking. Anne doesn't think she can hold it together. Nobody thinks Anne can hold it together. The police don't trust Anne to keep a cool head and follow instructions. She is too emotional. She has moments approaching hysteria. Marco is more rational, but he is certainly jumpy. Around 10 p.m., the phone rings. Marco reaches for it. Everyone can see that his hand is shaking. Hello, he says. There is nothing on the other end but breathing. Hello, Marco says more loudly, his eyes shifting quickly to Razbeck. Who is this? The caller hangs up. What did I do wrong? Marco says, panicked. Razbeck is by his side instantly. You didn't do anything wrong. Marco gets up and starts pacing the room. If that was the kidnapper, he'll call back, Razbeck says evenly. He's nervous too. Detective Razbeck watches Marco closely. Marco is clearly agitated, which is understandable. He is under a lot of pressure. If this is all an act, Razbeck thinks he's a very good actor. Anne is crying quietly on the sofa, periodically wiping her eyes with a tissue. Careful police work has determined that nobody with the garage opening into the lane was driving down the lane at 12:35 the night before. Of course, the lane is also used by others, not just those with garages there. It opens out to the side streets at each end, and drivers use it to get around the problem of one-way streets. The police are trying desperately hard to find the driver of that vehicle. Paula Dempsey is the one that they have found who saw the car at the time. If there's a kidnapper, Razbeck thinks, they would have probably heard from them by now. Perhaps there would never be any call from a kidnapper. Maybe the parents killed the baby and got help disposing of the body, and this is all elaborate charade to divert suspicion of the murder from them. The problem is, Razbeck has pulled their cell phone records and their home phone records, and there were no calls made by either of them to anyone after 6 o'clock the previous night, except the emergency call to 911, which means that if they did it, they might not have been spontaneous. Perhaps it was planned all along, and they prearranged to have somebody waiting in the garage. Or maybe one of them has an untraceable prepaid cell phone that was used. The police haven't found one, but that doesn't mean it didn't exist. If they got help disposing of the body, they must have called someone. The cell phone rings several more times. They have been told that there are murderers and to stop effing the police around. They have been told to pray. They have been ordered psychic services for a fee, but no one claiming to be the kidnapper has called. Finally, Anne and Marco go upstairs to bed. Neither one of them has slept in the last 24 hours, and for the day before that, Anne has tried to lay down, but she has been unable to sleep. Instead, she sees Cora in her mind's eye and can't believe that she is unable to touch her. She doesn't know where her baby is or if she is okay. Anne and Marco lie down on the bed together, in their clothes, ready to jump up if the phone rings. They hold each other and whisper, I wish I could see Dr. Lumsden. Anne says, Marco pulls her close. He doesn't know what to say. Dr. Lumsden is away in Europe somewhere for the next couple of weeks. whispers back. She said I could see the doctors was covering for her if I needed to. Maybe I should. Marco considers he's worried about her. He's worried that if this goes on too long, it will probably damage her. She has always been fragile when stressed. I don't know, baby, Marco says. With all of those reporters out there, how could you go to the doctors? I don't know, Anne whispers bleakly. She doesn't want the reporters following her to a psychiatrist's office either. She is worried about the press learning about her postpartum depression. She saw that they saw what they were like about the mistake with the onesie. So far, the only ones who don't know about her depression are Marco and her mother, her doctor and her pharmacist, and the police, of course, who went through their house right after the baby was taken and found her medication. If she hadn't been in treatment by a psychiatrist, would the police be circling him now like wolves? Maybe not. It's her fault they are under suspicion. The police have no reason to suspect them otherwise, unless it is just because they left the baby in the house alone. That was Marco's fault. They both are to blame. Anne lies in the bed remembering what it felt like to hold her baby against her body, to feel the warmth of her pudgy little infant daughter in her arms, wearing only a diaper. Her skin smelling of baby and bath time. She remembers Cora's beautiful smile and the curl in the middle of her forehead, like the little girl in the nursery rhyme. She and Marco have often joked about it. There was a little girl and she had a little curl right in the middle of her forehead. And when she was good, she was very, very good. And when she was bad, she was horrid. As broken as she feels, what kind of mother feels depressed after a gift of a perfect baby? Anne loves her daughter desperately. But the exhaustion has been overwhelming. Cora was a fussy, clicky baby, and demanding at the most. When Marco had gone back to work, the days had begun to feel very unbearably long. Anne filled the hours as best as she could, but it was lonely. All the days began to feel the same. She couldn't imagine them over being any different. In the fog of her sleep deprivation, she couldn't remember the woman she used to be when she worked at the art gallery. Couldn't hardly remember how it felt to help clients add pieces to their collections or the thrill of finding promising new artists. In fact, she could hardly remember what it was like before she had the baby and stayed home to take care of her. Anne didn't like to ask her mother to come and help. She was busy with her friends in the at the country club and her charities. None of Anne's own friends were staying home with babies at the same time. Anne struggled. She felt ashamed that she wasn't coping well. Marco suggested hiring someone to help, but that made her feel inadequate. The only relief was her mom's group, which met for 3 hours once a week on Wednesday mornings, but she hadn't had connected with any of the other moms sufficiently to share her feelings. They all seemed genuinely happy and competent at motherhood than she was, even though it was the first day for each of them, a first baby for each of them, sorry. And there was one session a week in the early evening with Dr. Lumsden while Marco watched Cora. All Anne wants right now is to go back 24 hours. She looks at the digital clock on her bedside table, 11:31. 24 hours ago, she was leaving Cora in her crib to return to the party. None of this had happened. Everything was fine. If only she could turn the clock back. If she could have her baby back, she would be grateful. She would be so happy. She didn't think she would ever be depressed again. She would cherish every moment with her daughter. She would never complain about anything ever again. Lying in bed, Anne makes a private deal with God. Even though she does not believe in God, she weeps into her pillow. John, they had to get professional help. Anne's own brother, mother, of course, had been no use. She bottle-filled, fed her baby. Marco wants to reach out and lightly stroke Anne's back, but he's afraid of waking her. She has always been emotional, sensitive. She is one of the most refined women he has ever met. He used to love dropping in on her at the gallery. Sometimes he would surprise her there at lunchtime or after work, just because he wanted to see her. He got a kick out of watching her with clients, the way she lit up when talking about a painting or a new artist. He'd think, "I can't believe she's mine." Whenever there was an opening for a new show, she would invite him. There would be champagne, hors d'oeuvres, women in smart dresses, and men in well-cut suits. Anne could circulate around the room, stopping to talk with people clustered in front of the paintings while abstract splashes of color or more somber tonal works. Marco didn't understand any of it. The most beautiful, the most arresting thing in the room for him would always be Anne. He would stay out of her way and stand over by the bar eating cheese or off to the side and watch her do her thing. She had been trained for it, getting her degree in art history and modern art. But more than that, she had instinct for it, a passion. Marco had not grown up with art, but it was a part of her life. He loved her for it. For their wedding, he bought her a painting in the gallery that she federally desired, but that she said they could never afford a large, moody, abstract work by an up-and-coming painter she greatly admired. It hangs over their mantelpiece in the living room, but she never even looks at it. Marco rolls onto his back and stares at the ceiling. His eyes burn. He needs her to keep it together. He can't have the police suspecting them, any more than they do already. What she said about Dr. Lumsden and disturbed him, the fear in her eyes. Had she said something to the doctor without wishing to harm the baby? That's what women with postpartum depression sometimes thought about. Jesus F. His computer was at the office. He googled postpartum depression and followed the links to the postpartum psychosis. Read those horrible stories about women who murdered their babies, the woman who had smothered her two kids, the woman who had drowned their five kids in a bathtub, the one who had driven her kids into the lake. Jesus effing Christ. If the police look at their computer at the office, they'll find all of that. Marco starts to sweat lying in bed. He feels clammy, sick. What would the police make of when they found it? Do they already know that Anne killed Cora? Wait, do they already think that Anne killed Cora? Do they think that he helped her cover it up? If they saw his browser history, would they think he'd been worried for weeks about Anne? He lies there flat on his back, eyes wide open. He should tell the police about it before they find it themselves. He doesn't want to look like he's hiding anything. They'll wonder why he researched it at work instead of using his home computer. His heart is racing now. As he gets up, he makes his way downstairs in the dark, leaving Anne snoring lightly behind him. Detective Rasbeck is in the chair in their living room, and he seems to have chosen his favorite, doing something on his laptop. Marco wonders if the detective ever sleeps, wondering if when he is going to leave their house. He and Anne can't exactly kick him out all day. They will both like to. Detective Rasbeck looks up at Marco and comes into the room. "I can't sleep," Marco mumbles. He sits down on the sofa, tries to think of how to begin. He can feel the detective eyes on him. Should he tell or not? Have they been to his office yet? Have they looked at his computer? Have they found out the mess his business is in? Do they know that he's at risk of losing his company? If they don't know yet, they soon will. He knows that they are suspicious of him, that they are looking into his background, but having financial problems doesn't make you a criminal. "There's something I'd like to tell you," Marco says nervously. Rasbeck looks at him calmly and puts his laptop aside. "I don't want you to misconstrue this," Marco says. "Okay," Detective Rasbeck says. Marco takes a deep breath before he begins. "When Anne was diagnosed with postpartum depression a few months ago, it really kind of freaked me out." Rasbeck nods. "That's understandable. I mean, I had no experience with this kind of thing. She was getting very depressed, you know, crying a lot. She seemed listless. I was worried about her, but I thought she was exhausted, that it was temporary. I thought she'd get over it when the baby started sleeping through the night. I even suggested that maybe she could go back to work part-time because she loved her job at the gallery, and I thought it would give her a break, but she didn't want to do that. She looked at me like I was a failure like she was a failure as a mother. Marco shakes his head. Of course, I didn't think that. I suggested she get a bit of help during the day. Maybe get a girl in so she could nap, but she wouldn't hear it. Razbag nods again, listening intently. Marco continues, feeling himself getting more nervous. When she told me, the doctor said she had postpartum depression. I didn't want to make it into a big deal, you know. I just wanted to be supportive, but I was worried, and she wasn't telling me much. He starts rubbing his hands on his thighs, so I looked it up online, but not here at home because I didn't want her to know that I was worried, so I used my computer at the office. He feels himself flushing. This is coming out all wrong. It sounds as if he suspects Anne, as if he doesn't trust her. It sounds like they are keeping secrets from one another. Razbag stares back at him, inscrutable. Marco can't make out what the detective is thinking. It's unnerving. So I just wanted you to know, if you checked my computer at work while I was looking at those sites about postpartum depression, I was trying to understand what she was going through. I wanted to help. I see. Razbag nods as if he completely understands, but Marco can't tell what he's really thinking. Why do you want to tell me that you were researching postpartum depression at your office? It seems a natural enough thing to do in your situation, Razbag says. Marco feels a chill. Has he just made things worse? Has he just made them want to examine his office computer? Should he explain further about the following, the links to the murders, or just leave things as is? For a moment, he panics, unsure of what to do. He decides he has already screwed up enough. I just thought I should tell you, that's all. Marco says gruffly and gets up to go, angry with himself. Wait, detective says, do you mind if I ask you something? Marco sits back down. Go ahead. He crosses his arms in front of him. It's about last night when you went to the neighbor's house after checking on the baby at 12:30. What about it? What were you and Cynthia talking about out there? The question makes Marco feel uncomfortable. What had they talked about? Why is he asking? Why do you want to know what we were talking about? Do you remember? Razbag says. Marco can't remember. He just doesn't remember talking much at all. I don't know. Just trivial stuff. Chit-chat. Nothing important. She's a very attractive woman. Wouldn't you agree? Marco is silent. Would you agree? Razbag repeats. I guess, Marco says. You said that you don't remember seeing or hearing anything when you were out back last night between shortly after 12:30 and just before 1 a.m. when the two of you returned inside. Marco hangs his head, doesn't look at the detective. He knows where this is going. He starts to sweat. You said, and here the detective flits back through his notebook for a bit. You said you weren't paying attention. Why were you not paying attention? What the heck could he do here? He knows the detective is getting at like a coward. Marco says nothing. He feels the pulse up in the vein in his temple and wonder if the detective noticed. Cynthia says that you came on to her like you made sexual advances to her out on the patio. What? No, I didn't. Marco lifts his head sharply and looks at the detective. The detective consults his notes again, flips some pages. She says you ran your hand up her legs, that you kissed her, pulled her onto your lap. She says you were quite persistent, that you got carried away. That's not true. It's not true. You didn't kiss her and get carried away. No, I mean, I didn't come on to her. She came on to me. Marco can feel himself blushing deeply and furious with himself. The detective says nothing. Marco fumbles over the words that, in his haste to defend himself, all the while thinking laughs, but there is no humor in it. Really, the police were swarming all over the place because a baby has been kidnapped, and we forgot that we have a pinhole camera trained in our backyard. She gets up and starts taking off her earrings. They're never going to believe that. Why not? We can say that we never checked it, or we thought it was broken, or that the battery was dead. We can say we thought it didn't work. It was just for a show. Just for a show to scare thieves away. When it's so well hidden that the police didn't even see it, she drops the earring into her mirror jewelry box on the dressing table. She shoots him an annoyed look and mutters, "You and your effing cameras." "You enjoy watching the films too," Graham says. Cynthia doesn't correct him. Yes, she enjoys watching the films too. She enjoys watching herself having sex with other men. She likes the way it turns on her husband and to see her with them. But what she enjoys even more is that it gives her permission to flirt and have sex with other men. More attractive and more exciting than her husband, who has proved to be a bit of a disappointment lately. But she didn't get very far with Marco. Graham had hoped that she would have been able to give Marco a proper blowjob, or that he would lift up her skirt and do her from behind. Cynthia knew exactly how the camera was positioned to get the best angle. Graham's job was to keep the wife occupied. That was his job. It was tedious for him, but it was worth it. Except now they have a problem. Chapter 12. It is Sunday afternoon. There have been no new leads. No one has called claiming to have Cora. The case appears to be at an impasse, but Cora is still out there somewhere. Where is she? Anne walks over to the living room window. The curtains are drawn shut for privacy, filtering the room's light. She stands to the side and holds the curtain open a little to peek out. There are little reporters on the sidewalk, spilling over into the street. She's living in a fishbowl. Everyone is tapping on the glass. Already there are indications that the Contis aren't turning out to be the media darlings that the press had hoped for. Anne and Marco haven't welcomed the media. They clearly see the reporters as an intrusion, a necessary evil. They are not particularly photogenic either. Even though Marco is handsome, Anne is pretty enough before, but it is not enough to be handsome. One should preferably have charisma, or at least warmth. There is nothing charisma about Marco now. He looks like a shattered ghost. They both look guilty, beaten down by shame. Marco has been cold in his interactions with the media. Anne has said nothing at all. They have not been warm to the press, and so the press is not warm to them. This is, Anne realizes, probably a tactical mistake, one they may live to regret. The problem is that they have not been home. It has come out that they were next door when Cora was taken from her crib. Anne was horrified when she saw the morning's headlines. Couple not home when baby taken, stolen baby was left alone. If they were sound asleep in their own house when their child was kidnapped from her room, there would have been more greater outpouring of sympathy from the press and the public. The fact that they were attending a party next door has scalded them. And of course, the postpartum depression has been made public. Anne doesn't know how these things happen. She certainly didn't tell the press. She suspects Cynthia might have been the source of the leak about their leaving the baby in the house, but she doesn't know how the media found out about her depression. Surely the police would not have leaked their private medical information. She has even asked them, and they said it didn't come from them. But Anne doesn't trust the police. Whoever is responsible for the leaks, they have only damaged Anne further in the eyes of everyone. The public, the press, her parents, her friends, and everyone. She has been publicly ashamed. Anne starts to look at the steadily increasing pile of toys and other colorful debris collecting on the sidewalk at the bottom of the front steps. There are bouquets of wilted flowers, stuffed animals, all colors and sizes. She can see the teddy bears, even an outsized giraffe with notes and cards stuck on them, a mountain of cliche. Such an outpouring of sympathy and of hate. Early that day, Marco had gone out and bought an armful of toys and notes into her to cheer her up. That was a mistake he won't make again. Most of the notes were venomous, even shocking. She read a few of them, gasped, balled them up, and threw them to the floor. She twitches at the curtains. She twitches the curtains with her fingers and looks out again. This time, a shrill of horror slides down her back. She recognizes the women coming single file down the sidewalk toward the house, pushing their baby strollers. It is four women from her mom's group. The reporters fall away to let them through, sensing impending trauma. escapes Anne when she returns abruptly from the window. What is it? Marco says, alarmed, coming up to her. He pushes the curtain aside and looks out the window at the sidewalk. Get rid of them, Anne whispers. Please. On Monday morning at 9 o'clock, Detective Raspack requests that Marco and Anne come to the police station for formal questioning. You are not under arrest. He assures them as they stare back at him, dumbstruck. We would like to take a statement from each of you and ask a few more questions. Why can't you do that here? Anne acts in obvious distress. Like you've been doing. Why do we have to go to the station? Marco echoes, looking appalled. It is standard procedure, Raspack says. Would you like some time to freshen up first, he suggests. Anne shakes her head as if she doesn't care what she looks like. Marco does nothing at all. He just stares at his feet. Okay, then let's go, Raspack says, and then leads the way. When he opens the front door, there is a flurry of activity. The reporters cluster around the front steps, cameras flashing. Are they under arrest? Someone calls out. Raspack answers no questions and remains totally silent as he steers Marco and Anne through the crush to the police cruiser parked in front of the house. He opens the rear door and Anne goes in first and slides across the back seat. Marco steps in after her. No one speaks except the reporters who clamor after them with their questions. Raspack climbs into the passenger seat and the car pulls away. The photographers run after them taking pictures. Anne stares out the window. Marco tries to hold her hand, but she pulls it away. She watches the familiar city pass by the window, the produce on the corner, and the park where she and Cora sit on the blanket in the shade and watch children splash in the wading pool. They cross the city. Now they are not very far from the art gallery where she used to work, close to the river. Then they are going past the Art Deco building where Marco has his office, and then they are downtown. It looks all different from the back of the police cruiser on the way to the question and the disappearance of your own child. When they arrive at the police station, the modern building, concrete glass, the cruiser stops at the front doors and Raspack shepherds them in. There are no reports here. There have been no advance warning that Marco and Anne will be taken for questioning. When they walk into the station, a ununiformed officer at a circular desk glances up with interest. Raspack hands Anne over to a female officer. Take her to interview room 3. Raspack tells her. Anne looks at Marco in alarm. Wait, I want to be with Marco. Can we be together? Anne asks. Why are you separating us? Marco says, it's okay, Anne. Don't worry. Everything is going to be okay. We haven't done anything. They just want us to ask us some questions, and then they are going to let us go. Isn't that right? He says to Raspack, a hint of challenge in his voice. That's right, the detective says smoothly. As I said, you are not under arrest. You are here voluntarily. You are free to leave at any time. Marco stands still and watches Anne go down the hall with the female officer. She turns back and looks at him. She's terrified. Come with me, Raspack says. He takes Marco into an interview room at the end of the hall. Detective Jennings is already there. The room contains a metal table with a single chair on one side and 2 chairs on the other side for the detectives. Marco doesn't trust himself to make any sense to keep things straight. He can feel the exhaustion hitting him. He tells himself to talk slowly to think before he answers. Raspack is wearing a clean suit and a fresh shirt and tie. He is newly shaven. Jennings is too. Marco is wearing old jeans and a wrinkled t-shirt that he hauled up out of his drawer earlier that morning. He hadn't known that he was going to be brought down to the station. He realizes now that he should have taken advantage of the detective's offer to shower, shave, and change clothes. He would have felt more alert. Just realized that he is probably going to be videotaped. Marco sits down nervously and watches the two detectives standing across the table from him. It is different being here instead of in his own home. It is frightening. He feels the shift of control. If it's okay with you, we're going to videotape this interview, Raspack says. He gestures to the camera positioned but just below the ceiling, pointing toward them to the table. Marco has no idea if he really has a choice. He hesitates for a fraction of a second, then says, yeah, sure, no problem. Would you like some coffee? Razbeck offers. Yeah, sure, thanks. Marco says he tries to relax. He reminds himself he's here to help the police find out who has taken his child. Razbeck and Janice go out to get coffee, leaving Marco alone to fret. When the detectives return, Razbeck places Marco's paper cup on the table in front of him. Marco sees that he has bought him two sugars and one cream. Razbeck has remembered how Marco takes his coffee. As Marco fumbles with the sugar packets, his hands are trembling. They all notice. Please state your name and today's date, Razbeck says, and they begin. The detective leads him through a series of straightforward questions that establish Marco's version of what happened the night of the kidnapping. It is a rehash of what has gone before and nothing new. Marco can feel himself relaxing as the interview progresses. Finally, he thinks that they are finished and they are about to let him go. His relief is enormous. Although he is careful not to show it, he has time then to wonder how it is going in the other room with Anne. Good, thank you, Razbeck says when they have taken his statement. Now, if you don't mind, I just have a few more questions. Marco, who has started to rise about his metal chair, sits back down. Tell us about your company, Conti Software Design. Why? Marco asks. What has my company got to do with anything? He stares at Razbeck, trying to hide his dismay. But he knows what they are getting at. They have been looking into him. Of course they have. You started your company about 5 years ago, Razbeck prompts. Yes, Marco says. I have degrees in business and computer science. I'd always wanted to go into business for myself. I saw an opportunity in software design, specifically in designing user interfaces for medical software. So I started my own company. I've got some key clients, a small staff of software design professionals, all working remotely. Mostly we visit clients on site, so I travel a fair bit on business, and I keep an office downtown for myself. We have been really quite successful. Yes, you have done very well, Razbeck agrees. Impressive. It can't be that easy. It's expensive to start a company like that. It depends. It started out very small, just me and a couple of clients. I was the only designer in the beginning. I worked from home and put in very long hours. My plan was to build the business gradually. Go on, Razbeck says. The company has been very successful very quickly. It grew fast. I needed to hire more designers to keep up with the demand and to take the business to the next level. So I expanded. The time was right. There were bigger costs than equipment, staff, office space. You need money to grow. And where did you get that money from to expand your business? The detective asks. Marco looks at him annoyed. I don't see why it matters to you. But I got a loan from my in-laws, Anne's parents. I see. What do you see? Marco says irritably. He has to calm down. He can't afford to get ruffled. Razbeck is probably doing this just to piss him off. I didn't mean anything by it, the detective says mildly. How much money did you get from your wife's parents? Are you asking me or you don't know already? Marco says, I don't know. I'm asking. $500,000, Marco says. That's a lot of money. Yes, it is. Marco agrees. Razbeck is beating him. He can't rise to it. And he has the business. And has the business been profitable? For the most part, we have good years and not so good years like anybody else. What about this year? What do you say? Has it been a good year or a not good year? It has been rather a poopy year, since you ask. Marco asks. Marco says, I'm sorry to hear that, Razbeck says, and wait. We have some setbacks, Marco says finally, but I'm confident that things will get back on track. Business is always up and down. You can't just throw in the towel when you have a bad year. You have to tough it out. Razbeck nods thoughtfully. How would you describe your relationship with your wife's parents? Marco knows that the detective has seen him and his father-in-law in the same room. There is no point in lying. We don't like each other. And yet they still loaned you $500,000. The detective eyebrows have gone up. Her mother and father together loaned it to us. They have the money. They love their daughter. They want her to have a good life. My business plan was sound. It was a solid business investment for them and an investment in their daughter's future. It has been satisfactory arrangements for all concerned. But isn't it the case that your business desperately needs a cash infusion? Razbeck asks. Every business these days could use a cash infusion, Marco says, almost bitterly. Are you on the verge of losing your company that you worked so hard to build? Razbeck says, leaning forward slightly. I don't think so, no, Marco says. He is not going to let understand. Razbeck says, have you approached your in-laws for help? Marco sidesteps the question. I think things will turn around. Razbeck lets it go. Let's talk about your wife for a moment. He says, you say that she's been depressed. You told me earlier that she was diagnosed with postpartum depression by her doctor. Our psychiatrist, a doctor, he consults his notes, Lumsden. He lifts his eyes, who is currently away. Yes, you know that, Marco says. How many times do we have to go over this? Can you describe her symptoms for me? Marco moves restlessly in his uncomfortable metal chair. He feels like a worm pinned to a headboard. As I've told you before, she was sad, crying a lot, listless. She seemed overwhelmed at times. She wasn't getting enough sleep. Corey's a pretty fussy baby. When he says this, he remembers that she is gone and he has to pause a moment to regain himself control. I suggested that she get someone to help her with the baby so that she could take a nap during the day, but she wouldn't. I think she felt she could just manage it on her own without help. Your wife has a history of mental illness. Marco looks up startled. What? No, she has a bit of a history of depression like a million other people. His voice is firm. Mental illness, no. Marco doesn't like what the detective is suggesting. He braces himself for what is coming next. Postpartum depression is considered a mental illness, but let's not quibble. Razbeck leans back in his chair and looks at Marco as if to say, can we speak frankly? Did you ever worry that Anne might harm the baby or harm herself? No, never. Even though you looked up postpartum psychosis on the internet, so they have been through his computer. They've seen what he looked at, the stories about the women murdering their babies. Marco can feel that sweat break out on his in tiny beads on his forehead. He moves around in the chair. No, I told you about that. When Anne was diagnosed, I wanted to know more about it. So I did some searches on postpartum depression. You know what it's like on the internet. One thing leads to another. You follow the links. I was just curious. I didn't read those stories about women who went crazy and killed their kids because I was worried about Anne. No way. Razbeck stares at him without saying anything. Look, if I was worried about Anne harming her baby, I wouldn't have left her home alone with the baby all day, would I? I don't know, would you? The gloves have come off. Razbeck looks at him, waiting. Marco glares back. Are you going to charge us with something? Marco asks. Not at this time, the detective says. You are free to go. Marco stands up slowly, pushing his chair back. He wants to run the heck out of here, but he's going to take his time. He's going to look like he's in control, even if it's not true. Just one more thing, Razbeck says. Do you know anyone with an electric car or possibly a hybrid? Marco hesitates. I don't think so, he says. That's all. The detective says, rising from his chair, thanks for coming in. Marco wants to get right into Razbeck's face and snarl. Why don't you do your job and find her baby? But instead, he strides too quickly out of the room. Once outside the door, he realizes he doesn't know where Anne is. He cannot leave without her. Razbeck comes up behind him. If you'd like to wait for your wife, we shouldn't be too long, he says, and goes into the corridor and opens a door into another room where, Marco presumes, his wife is waiting. So that was the chapters 9 through 12. Things are getting juicy, I'm telling you. But I will see you guys in the next